Good morning, everyone, and welcome to City Hope Online. How are you, Paul?
I'm in a good mood, Tash.
Oh, you're always in a good mood. Well, most of the time, anyway. Seems like ages since we were last here.
Do you know what? It's been weeks, but it's good to be back.
It sure is. Can you believe it's the 1st of November?
Yeah, it's nearly Christmas, man.
All right, Paul, steady on. Before we go talking about Christmas, I'm still reflecting on how good our Black History Month programme was.
I loved it. So good. And your brother was good. The art show was brilliant. Thanks.
Thank you. So, what have we got lined up today?
Well, in a little while, Chris will be preaching to us from 1 Corinthians. And our marvellous musicians this week are Tim, Lucia and Chris. And we've got a couple of top testimonies as well.
That all sounds good, but right now we have the wonderful City Kids to lead us into worship.
Jesus, thank you that you always keep your promises and that you never promise and you don't keep your word, and that we can always rely on you. Amen.
Thank you, God, that you are the same today
as you were yesterday, as you will be too.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you that we can trust you and that we know that you will keep your promises. Thank you that you're always with us and that you are God and that will never change. Amen.
For the Lord is good.
For the Lord is good.
For the just want to thank you for the opportunity to come before you and worship you. And we just lift you up and praise you, Lord. And we ask for you to touch everyone who is listening to this. And we ask for the Holy Spirit to come, bless every home and bless every heart. Just speak to us today, Lord God. Speak into our lives. Give us strength in difficult times. We just thank you for being our rock and our shield in these times, Father God. We give you praise and thanks.
Blessing and honor, glory and power, into the ancients of day. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the ancient of days. Every time in heaven and earth shall declare your glory, every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. Exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O ancient of days. Blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the ancients of days. From every nation, shall bow at your throne in worship. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for sending your one and only begotten Son to die on the cross for us. Thank you, Lord, that he died so that we can have life. And Lord, I just pray that as we walk in this life, Lord Jesus, we don't have to be heavily burdened, because Lord, you say in your word that we can cast all our burdens onto you. And Lord, I want to just thank you also because you love us so much and unconditionally. And in turn, we as stewards just want to go out and just really reach out to people, Lord Jesus, and shine your light for your glory, Lord. So I ask this in Jesus' name, I pray, amen.
Jesus, we honor your name, Lord. Yours is the highest name of all. Jesus, O power and glory belong to you only.
Don't worry about anything, instead pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all that He's done. And this week I was clearing out drawers and wardrobes and cupboards, and I found so many notebooks with so many prayers written in them from over the years. And as I was reading them, I saw so many answers to prayer. And some of them were really, really small things. Some of them were big things, and you know, as I looked at them, I just thought, wow, God, you are so faithful. There's things in there that haven't been answered yet, but I think they're ongoing things. And it really spoke to me that, God, you really care about the smallest details and about the biggest things. And over lockdown, as I've spent more time praying, because I've had more time, I've really realised that there is so much power in Jesus, that as we pray, we can ask God for big things and know that He hears us, and He can answer big, big prayers. And my faith level has gone up higher than it's ever been. And especially after what happened to Charlie, he was written in one of my books, and his name was in there many, many times. And I think, thank you, God, for what you did. So at the moment, I'm praying for somebody who's 29 with cancer. It's a lady I work with. She came and found me and said, Denise, would you pray for my brother-in-law? He's got cancer. He's 29. And they thought he had appendicitis, but it was cancer, and it had spread a bit in his body. And I am going to God, and I'm saying, God, you have to heal him. He's 29. They've just had a baby. You have to do it, God. Please. And I've got faith for that God can heal him. So yeah, I just wanted to encourage you today, don't ever give up praying. It says in the Bible, doesn't it, keep praying. And yeah, don't give up, keep praying, and God is a faithful God.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us His precious blood. Who is love will not remember, who can cease to sing His praise. He will God's mercy flowed a vast and great. precious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers poured incessant from above, and in peace and perfect justice kiss the guilty world in. Engage with God now, just as we play. Just want to let God just speak to us, minister to us as we receive from Him.
So you've seen God intervene in family situations. And just tell us a little bit about that. I know it's very detailed, but you can tell us a little bit about that.
It's to do with my daughter and allowing her to travel back in 2016 with her dad.
Travel back to?
To Jamaica, okay. For the summer holiday. And, for all of us to have traveled at the time. But they went together, and then my son and myself, we travelled 10 days later. Mm-hmm. And only to find out that he didn't have any intention of having her return back to the UK.
So he wanted her to stay in Jamaica with him.
Yes.
That must have been hard.
It was.
So what did you do?
It was the hardest thing that we had to deal with. And it took some getting used to.
So you're in Jamaica at the time?
Yes.
So just talk us through what happened.
It was just a blur because we weren't expecting it. As far as we knew, we were just going out for the summer holiday and to see my dad and for us to return.
Okay. Back,
because I bought uniforms and everything for the children to start school,
yes,
in September, and found out that, okay, she's not going back. She's staying in Jamaica, and I had to deal with it.
And her dad had control of her passport?
Yes.
Okay.
So what do you do?
So you had to come home with your young son?
Yes. After being stuck for close to a year. Yeah. There.
Wow.
Made the decision because that was the only way I was going to have her back with us, and initiated a court process. And it took 6 months for her to get back here, along with a lot of praying. A lot of praying, not just from myself,
yes,
but from, you know, everyone, a lot of people around, people from within the church as well, and, yeah, you know, from yourself, from Vic.
I also remember that you weren't at your best, understandably. Often there were tears at, yes, Sunday services.
Yes. And I remember one Sunday, because I was just breaking down each time I would come into church. And one Sunday, it was just so much. And I left work at the Hub setting at the time.
When we were meeting at Harris Academy.
And I left the building and walked into the kitchen area just to sit down to have my cry and, you know, just to recuperate and everything, mm-hmm, only to see Hilda coming into the room saying she noticed that I've been crying a lot, you know, when I come to church and what was going on. And I explained to her, you know, the situation that I was facing with my daughter.
And what did she say to you?
She said that I need to forgive. And at the time, that wasn't the easiest.
I'm sure.
It wasn't. I told her, I said, I can't. I can't forgive him, not because, you know, because of what he had done. And she said to forgive, because that is the only way that I'm going to get through it. And was to just leave it all to God.
So you was able to forgive, and you was able to give the burden over,
yes,
to him?
Yes, I did. I passed it over to him, prayed a lot, you know, and said, God, this is what I'm asking you for.
So what lesson did you learn for all the, because through lots of heartache, years,
yes,
of heartache,
yes,
what,
yes,
lesson did you learn?
Just to be faithful. And, you know, because as individuals, we go through a lot of challenges.
Mm-hmm.
But if we continue to pray and just know that there's a God and allow him to take control and just take charge, then he, you know, he will see us through. He sees us through because he did it for me twice. Did it for me with my dad.
Yes.
And he did it for me with Olivia as well.
He is faithful.
He is faithful.
Hello. We've not had a food bank update for a while. So food bank has been transitioning over the last few weeks into going back to the needing a voucher to access it. So the last few weeks we've been telling people where they can get more help, where they can get a voucher from. So we have been a little bit less busy, which means we've been able to spend more time really making sure that people get the help that they need. Also, we've been doing Tuesday church for the last 6 weeks. So this has been a really good opportunity to really bless people. We've been showing excerpts from the online services. We've been doing a little live talk, giving people tea and cake. And people have been really receptive to that, and we've been full as we can be in the current COVID-19 times. CAP are continuing to grow. With Steve Lee now up and running, seeing new clients, and Kath King is in the process of completing her online training. So that means we are open to helping more people with their debt issues. So as you can see, there's quite a lot going on at the moment. We really do need your prayers, but it's just we just really want to be able to really help the most vulnerable in our communities.
Great stuff. Thank you, guys. Food bank is so important in these difficult times, isn't it? Next week is Remembrance Sunday, and as usual, we'll be marking that occasion here at City Hope.
I'm looking forward to that. I remember last year Hannah's moving testimony about her experience during the war in Sierra Leone. Don't forget, at the end of the service, our prayer rooms will be open on Zoom. In a moment, it's Chris, but first we have a new feature hosted by Xenia and Jonathan called Curator's Corner. Xenia is a TV producer with a passion for ancient history, especially the Greeks and Romans. Over to Xenia and Jonathan for Curator's Corner.
Good morning, City Hope, and welcome to Curator's Corner, where we explore the real world of the New Testament. I'm joined this morning by Xenia. Xenia, what do you have for us?
Hi. So yeah, I thought we'd talk about the Corinthians. So the next few sermons are going to be on Paul's letter to the Corinthians. So I thought it might be interesting to find out, you know, what the people were like that Paul is talking to in this letter, what Corinth was like as a city to live in ancient times.
Fantastic. All right, first things first, geography of Corinth. Now, I remember we went there on a honeymoon, mm-hmm. and it was somewhere in Greece.
Yes. Yes, it's about an hour's drive out of Athens. So yeah, Corinth is in Greece. Greece is kind of divided into three parts, roughly, geographically. You've got the northern bit, that tends to be referred to as the mainland. Then you've got the southern bit, which is called the Peloponnese. It's kind of shaped like a fist with three fingers coming out the bottom. And then it's got the islands all around the edge. And Corinth is actually the linking point between mainland Greece and the Peloponnese, which makes it very important for both overland trading routes, goods flowing between the mainland and the Peloponnese and vice versa. But also, it's situated on what's called an isthmus. That's just a fancy word for land bridge. It means that it's surrounded on both sides by sea. So it's also important for trade coming in by sea. And this means that Corinth actually has two harbours. One in the north, called Lycaon Harbour, and one in the south, called Cenchreae. Now, we actually know that there was also a church at Cenchreae, because in Paul's letter to the Romans, he talks about a woman called Phoebe, who was a deacon, so someone with a position of responsibility in the church at Cenchreae.
So, great, a lot going on in the region. Mm-hmm. How did Corinth's position as this gateway influence the way it developed?
So, we've got Corinth is a trading hub. And in trading hubs, it's not just the flow of goods. It's the flow of people and ideas. So it's quite an exciting place to be. Lots of people from all different parts of the ancient world coming in and through Corinth.
And what about art? Was there any influences that came there?
So Corinth was very famous for its pottery. In fact, here, I've got a picture that you took in the Corinth Museum of a 6th century BC pot. This is very, very old. In fact, they're really just learning to draw animals properly.
Looks like a weird cat, yes. Cow hybrid.
Yeah, and the owl is better like way too big. But they're quite good at triangles and geometric patterns, so well done, the very ancient Greeks. And then a bit later on, you get this style of pottery. Now, this is very cool. You can see the artwork is a lot more sophisticated here. But this design of pot is called a lekythos. And that's because it has this thin neck. So it was designed to store an awful lot of liquid, but you only wanted to pour out a little bit of liquid at a time. So it's used for things like oils or perfumes. And again, this kind of points us to this idea that Corinth was somewhere where there was a lot of wealth. If you've got a lot of lekythoi, you must have a lot of high-value liquids.
I mean, if you want one for Christmas, you could just ask. Brilliant. Is there anything else you want to tell us about Corinth that will help us understand who Paul was writing to?
So Corinth has quite an interesting history. By the time Paul gets there, it's been inhabited for 4,000 years already, with one quite significant gap. Okay, so in ancient Greece, Corinth was a very, very important city. Because of the trade. But when the Roman Empire takes over Greece, the final battle that decides the fact that Greece is now going to be absorbed into the Roman Empire actually happens at Corinth. And they destroy the entire city. Almost no one lives there for 100 years until Julius Caesar refounds the city in 44 BC, actually quite soon before he gets assassinated.
What a way to finish.
I know. and it becomes this Roman trade hub in the middle of a Greek environment. So a Latin-speaking enclave in the middle of a Greek community. So by the time Paul gets there in the 50s AD, the current infrastructure of Corinth is actually only 100 years old.
Like a Roman phoenix rising from the Greek ashes.
Yeah, I suppose you could put it that way.
Awesome.
In that sense, it's a little bit like, we could think of it as a bit like Singapore today, somewhere with a rich history of its own, but actually a very recent infrastructure, somewhere that's very hot on trade, that's at an important trading point, very close to sea routes, somewhere where there are a lot of different people flowing through, where there are a lot of ideas and goods and financial deals all happening at the same time. It's a really, really exciting place to be, is ancient Corinth.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Xenia. That's all we've got time for this morning on Curator's Corner, but join us next time to learn more about the world of the New Testament.
Bye.
Bye.
Good morning and hello, and if you could cast your minds back to pre-lockdown. In our grown-up part of the service, I know some of the kids, you were up in your groups, but in the grown-up service, we had started a sermon series looking at the book of 1 Corinthians, which was a letter written by the Apostle Paul. Paul Brown had spent the first week explaining some of the context of that letter. And it's been fascinating to hear Xenia tell us a little bit more about Corinthian culture. So as we've heard, Corinth was a Greek-Roman pagan city and a very important trade route. But it was also becoming known as a bit of a party town, a city where anything goes. In modern terms, you might compare it to an island like Ibiza or a city like Amsterdam. It was liberal, thrill-seeking, anything-goes kind of city. And Corinth's economy would have relied quite a great deal on this reputation that it had. Now, of course, within Corinth, there would have been plenty of people that weren't living that kind of lifestyle, but nonetheless, it was an important reputation for them. It was into this culture that the Apostle Paul had gone to preach the gospel. He looked at Corinth and said, do you know what it needs? It needs to hear about Jesus Christ. And so he went, he preached the gospel, and many people came to put their faith in Jesus Christ. People from the Jewish community and people from the Greek community. And for the Greeks, following Christ meant giving up a lot of their old way of life. It meant giving up worshipping certain Greek and Roman gods or goddesses. It meant giving up certain elements of their pagan lifestyles. It meant giving up certain ways of thinking that just weren't compatible with Christian behavior. And so Paul started a church with this group of people, first Jews and Gentiles from a pagan background. And he spent about a year and a half building the church before he left that city to go somewhere else to preach the gospel and plant another church. But not long after Paul had left, he heard that there were some problems within the church in Corinth. There were arguments and divisions forming right across the church. Some of the Jews were suggesting that as well as trusting in the gospel, Christians should observe some of the Jewish rules and laws. On the other hand, some of the Greek Gentiles were suggesting exactly the opposite. As well as trusting the gospel, Christians should be free to observe some of the pagan ways of thinking and living. And so Paul writes this letter to the church to sort these arguments out. And the first thing he does is he calls the church to unity, to remember that they are all part of the same church, that they're part of the same body. And the head of the body, the leader of the body, is not Paul or Apollos or some other person or some way of thinking. The head of the body is Christ Jesus himself. And as we go through the series looking at the book of Corinthians, you're going to hear Paul, the Apostle Paul, using this metaphor of the body a lot. He uses it because it talks of unity and of shared purpose. And he also uses this metaphor of the body to come against some of the Greek, Roman, pagan ways of viewing the body, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more in a moment. So once Paul has talked about unity, he moves on in his letter to write about some more specific problems that the church was facing. So if you read chapters 5 to 7, you find him focusing on issues to do with marital unfaithfulness, sexual immorality, and questions around marriage and singleness. So Paul's aim in writing this letter is to bring unity to the church, to correct some misguided thinking, and to set the church back on the right track for godly living. So with all that said, I'd love you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. And as you look for that, I need to give a little bit of a parental warning. Every Friday evening in the Nicholson household, we have film night. We eat dinner together, then we get a load of beanbags and put them in front of the TV, and we watch some amazing blockbuster on Netflix. Now, invariably, the film turns out to be so good that I end up falling asleep after about 10 minutes. But because our youngest daughter is only 4 years old, we have to watch films that tend to be around a PG rating. Occasionally, we might brave it and go for a 12 or 12 plus, but you have to be careful when you do that, because sometimes you watch a 12 plus and you think, this isn't suitable for a 12-year-old or a 15-year-old, or I don't even feel that comfortable watching this, let alone having a 4-year-old watching it. And I say that because since lockdown, we've tried to keep our sermon series rated at a PG level or below. We're very aware that there's lots of kids in the room. But after making the decision to go back to our series in Corinthians, I realized that some of the subject matters that we're going to be addressing might be rated kind of 12 plus. And in fact, Johan, who's living with us at the moment, when I told him what I was preaching on, he said, you need to let the parents know to watch out for this, because it gets a bit saucy in places. So I'm going to do my best to keep the rating low whilst allowing the Apostle Paul's words to have the impact that they should. But what I'd love to do is encourage you over the next few days to read through 1 Corinthians chapters 5 and 6. If possible, print them off and get a highlighter and read through it and making notes of everything that you notice. Ask yourself, what makes you feel uncomfortable about what Paul says? Is there anything that you feel would clash with today's society? And ask yourself, why do I feel like this? Why do I feel uncomfortable? What's going on in myself? And how should we apply these words today? And if you do that, then actually when you get together in your connect groups, you could start having conversations about it, and you could have some quite interesting debates. But I want to encourage you, do it in love. Do it remembering that every single person is made in the image of God. And let's see what kind of conversations we're going to end up having. Okay, so let's read the scriptures together. Now, for your information, as we read this, you need to understand Paul's having a kind of rhetorical question with himself. A conversation with himself. He makes a statement that someone from a pagan background might say, and then he makes a counter statement from a perspective of someone who's a Christian. Okay, so let me read it. From verse 12, it says, I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. You say food for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy them both. But the body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? And I'm going to skip forward to verse 19. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you and whom you've received from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. What I want to do over the next few minutes is try as best I can to explain what Paul is saying in this passage. And in this passage, we see that what we do with our bodies does matter to God. That we are part of the body of Christ, and that we are meant to use our bodies to honor Christ. And finally, that our physical bodies carry with them the very presence of God. Now, all of us have been brought up in a particular culture, and that culture would have had a huge impact on how we view the world. on what you believe is good and bad, right or wrong, righteous or unrighteous. It will have a profound effect on everything you think. And no one who has ever lived can escape this. If you lived 500 years ago, your views and perspectives would be very different to what they are today. If you were born, and perhaps you were born in a different nation, your worldview, your understanding of how the world works will be very different to people that have been brought up solely in the UK. Now, the dominant or the loudest culture here in the UK could be described as secularism. And here are some traits of secularism. It rejects, on the whole, the idea of the Christian God. It has a high and noble concern for the individual. It can be spiritual, but it doesn't like the idea of any God who would have or would require anything of us. On one level, it's a culture that appears to have a clear sense of right or wrong. But on another level, this moral code, this understanding of right and wrong, is constantly evolving and changing. In today's dominant culture here in the West, a good slogan or a proverb that would fit well with the way it thinks would be, do whatever you want to do as long as it doesn't hurt anyone else. Or be true to who you really are. In Corinth, the dominant culture was a bit different to that. It was heavily influenced by Greek philosophers such as Plato. And in very simple terms, and if you're a philosopher, I'm very sorry if I'm not doing this very well, but in very simple terms, Plato taught that the body and the soul were to be viewed separately. The soul is an eternal force that lives beyond physical death. The body, however, is a temporary structure, a sack of bones that is destined to be destroyed very soon. And as this belief grew and evolved, the idea that our bodies and our souls were disconnected grew. Bodies became functional, needy, kind of temporary homes for the most important part of us, which was our soul. And since our bodies were not important, why can't we just have fun with them? Why can't we just make the most of them? Let's just do what we want with them. Whatever brings pleasure or happiness or power or wealth, let's just go with that. A way Paul described it is, let's just eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. And the Apostle Paul seemed to think that this kind of idea was very common among the Corinthians. And some influential people in the church had begun to reintroduce this idea to the church. They were trying to fuse their pagan backgrounds and identity with their Christian identity. And in this passage, Paul is exploring this idea and explaining why they're just not compatible, why you can't have a pagan lifestyle married to a Christian lifestyle. He says, I have the right to do anything. And that was a very Corinthian way of looking at things. If I've got the money and I've got the ways of doing it, I've got the right to do anything. But not everything is beneficial. And this is probably a saying that we've heard quite a lot in our own culture. I've got the right to do anything. As long as it doesn't hurt someone else, I can do what I want. But Paul says, just because you can do something, it doesn't mean it's beneficial for you or for others. Just because it feels good, it doesn't make it right. I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. Do you know, I've known Christians, people that have been following Jesus, who have seen their own lives and the lives of their families ruined by things like gambling. And what started off as a cheeky flutter here or there became a regular pastime. And sooner or later, that regular pastime became a problem to them and they were getting themselves into debt. And sooner or later, that pastime became an unshakable stronghold in their life. And you look back and you think, this person was going for God. They were Christians. They were followers of Jesus. What happened? Well, it started off small and became a stronghold. For someone else, it might be that, you know, a way of just relaxing at the end of the day. is to have a drink, but that drink becomes a daily habit, which becomes something they rely on to get them through the week, which in turn begins to change the way they interact with others, and it can end up ruining friendships and families. I know Christians who struggle daily with the temptation of looking at images on the internet that they know are unhealthy. And what started off as a seemingly harmless way of venting some frustration or coping with loneliness or entertaining some kind of curiosity becomes a habit that just takes control of the person. It can end up destroying relationships and marriages whilst continuing the harrowing trade of human exploitation right across the world. Now, the world might say, whatever you want to do in the privacy of your own home, you can do that. But God says, not everything is beneficial. We might say, I've got the right to do anything. But God says, but don't be mastered by anything. Now, these might have been obvious examples that I've just given. And I wanted to kind of think of some more creative ones. But the truth is, these are examples that are really common today. And there's probably people in our church that are struggling with one or other, or maybe a combination of these. And I'd really encourage you, don't just sit on it. Just secrecy is what everyone goes to secrecy. But don't allow that to happen. You need to speak to someone about it. You need to find someone who's you can trust, who's a man or a woman of God, and go and speak to them, and they can help you through that situation. He goes on to say, food for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy them both. Many scholars believe that this could have been a Corinthian saying that was basically saying, look, our physical bodies have certain needs and cravings. We need food, we need intimacy. Let's not get prudish about it. Let's give our bodies what we want. They're going to get destroyed in the end anyway. But Paul says, no. No, your bodies are important, and food is good, and sex is good, but they're not the sole reason for your bodily existence. You weren't just made for them. You were made to honor God with your whole being, including your body. We are called to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Your whole being, including your body, is valuable, and it matters to God how you use them. He goes on to say, by his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us too. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is within you and who you receive from God? You are not your own. You were brought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. In a few weeks' time, we're going to see that after Christ died, he didn't just rise spiritually, he rose physically. He was there in the flesh. He ate fish, as we all like to say. And for Paul, this was very important. But here's the point for today. Corinthian culture believed that one day we would be released from these bodies of ours, that we would be freed from the restrictions and the limitations that they have. But Paul here is saying, your body is important because it is part of who you are, and they help reveal the glory of Christ to the watching world, and they are temples of the Holy Spirit. You do not need to leave your body or change your body or despise your body in order to be who God has made you to be. You need to get this. Your body is a temple of the living God. The Spirit of God has made his heavenly home in you. Is our Drummond Road building a temple? No. Is St. Paul's Cathedral a temple? No. Is the Vatican a temple? No. But your body is a temple of the living God. Isn't that incredible? We don't have to wait until we die to experience the presence of God. He wants to make his home in us, in your body. But we've got to prepare him room. Surely that's what he deserves. Do you not know that your body is a temple for the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price, therefore honor God with your body. So in summary, what you do with your body matters to God. He longs to lead you into wholeness and purity for the benefit of yourself and for the benefit of all those around you. We are part of the body of Christ, and we are meant to use our bodies to honor Christ, and our physical bodies carry with them the very presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hey, City Hope, let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your words. I thank you for the words that Chris has brought to us this morning. I thank you, Lord, that we are valued in your eyes, and actually how we use our bodies and our minds here on earth is important to you. And Lord Jesus, you have set kind of boundaries around us, not to restrain us, but Lord Jesus, to bring us life and freedom. And I pray for City Hope that the church would know life and freedom at this time. Let us be a church that walks in the light, walks free of sin, walks free of temptation. And Lord Jesus, that we would be those that stand shoulder to shoulder as we move forward in our journey with you. So Holy Spirit, I pray, please come and touch anyone's heart and mind right now who maybe needs to know freedom, who perhaps, Lord Jesus, needs to repent and say sorry to you and turn around and perhaps start living differently for the King. So Father, I know from my own experience, you've done that in my life, and I have found great freedom in you. And so Lord Jesus, I pray that for others in the church, that they too would know freedom from sin, freedom from shame, and to live as you would want them to. Holy Spirit, we thank you and praise you. In your mighty name I ask this. Amen.
Go!
Chris, there's a serious challenge for a lot of us there. If you have been challenged by Chris's words, you can respond right now by going to our Zoom prayer rooms, but do speak with someone or get together with someone to pray with them. We want the challenge of Scripture, don't we, on our lives. We want to be moved from one place to another, one degree of glory to the next. Also, don't forget, tonight we have our Zoom prayer meeting. You should have been emailed the link to that. I hope to see you there. I'm looking forward to praying together. Other than that, Tash?
Well, thank you to everybody who's contributed to our service today. I guess all that's left to say is have a good rest of the day and a good week ahead.
See ya.
Take care.
Every sickness, you're the healing hand. For every prisoner, you're deliverance. For every lost soul, you're the promised land. Our breakthrough, you're our breakthrough. Out of the ashes, you make beautiful. When there is no way, you're the miracle. Only you do the impossible. I break through, you're I break through. Every mountain moves with a word from you. They surrender to your glory and majesty. Winds and waves obey the power of your name. Jesus, we proclaim your glory. Your majesty. Out of the ashes you make beautiful. When there is no way, you're the miracle. And only you do the impossible. Your eye breakthrough. Your eye breakthrough. To remember your goodness, we will not forget to remember your faithfulness. We will not forget to remember your goodness, we will not forget. 'Cause every mountain moves, every mountain moves.